Hey, yo, from the Kingdom of Ohio, you are listening to the OCCULTURE podcast. I am your host, Ryan Peverly. Welcome to the show, wherever you're listening and however you're listening. Thanks for being here. You know, I remember the first time I sat down and watched Night of the Living Dead. I was 16 years old, and I rented the VHS tape, no joke, from my local video store around this time of year. And I was blown away by the aesthetic of the film, the black and white, the social commentary, and what I would later come to know as the zombie motif in fiction. And I've been not obsessed, but heavily interested in this motif since then. I've been looking for someone to chat with about it for 2 years now. Because not only is the zombie an integral part of horror fiction and greater pop culture, it's an integral part of an entire sociopolitical and religious structure that emanates in Haiti. And you wouldn't know that if all you know about the zombie is from George Romero films or Walking Dead comic books. Thankfully, our guest this time, Dr. John Cussans, is in the house to dig deep into the history of the zombie and tell us about something he calls the zombie complex. John is an artist, writer, and educator based in London with an academic background in art history and theory and cultural history. His work is informed by critical reevaluations of an anthropological theory in the mid-20th century and investigates patterns of theoretical and practical convergence between contemporary art, philosophy, psychology, social movements, and popular culture from a post-colonial and anti-imperialist perspective. And that is the foundation for his book, Undead Uprising, Haiti, Horror, and the Zombie Complex, which explores the uses of Haiti as a locus for Euro-American fears about African culture and spirituality in the Americas, and their sublimation with popular horror tropes. And all of that forms the basis for our chat here. So let's barricade that door, equip that baseball bat, and do our best to quell the undead uprising. Enjoy. Dr. John Cussans, really appreciate your time.
Good to be here.
Absolutely, yeah. So before we get into your book, Undead Uprising, let's talk a little bit about you. What does the doctor and Dr. John Cussans mean? What did you do your PhD in?
Yeah, I did my PhD in cultural history between 91 and 95 at the Royal College of Art in London. And the Undead Uprising book in many ways comes out of the research I did there. I did a PhD that looked at something in the UK called the video nasty controversy, which was basically at the time that videos became widely available in homes in the UK in the early 80s, video players and the video market. There was a number of videos that were very violent and sadistic, things like Faces of Death and Driller Killer. There's about 30 or so, which were deemed too violent for popular consumption. And there was a tabloid newspaper campaign against them. And I wrote about that historical controversy from a theoretical perspective drawn from the French philosopher Georges Bataille, which was quite an idiosyncratic conjunction, really. But Bataille was a philosopher of horror. Bataille had a lot of ideas about the revolutionary powers of horror. And my question basically was, is there anything revolutionary about extremely sadistic horror films that you know, we can ascertain from these videos, or is that idea entirely erroneous in a nutshell? So I did a PhD in cultural history at the Royal College of Art, and so I became a doctor of horror, as it were.
That's awesome. I've never met a doctor of horror. This is a first for me. Well, let's back up and answer that question. You said, was there anything revolutionary about horror? What was your conclusion?
Well, yeah, it's a kind of double conclusion, really. I think a philosophical engagement with horror is essential for thinking through what the human is and what the human can be. And I'm very sympathetic to the notion of thought at its outermost limits, especially the thought of the human. And so for thinking through you know, revolutionary social transformation, one inevitably comes up against what it is to be human. So from a philosophical perspective, I think there's still a power, a revolutionary power of horror on a kind of philosophical and perhaps a subjective level, what horror does to one's sense of self and one's sense of those around us. But in a mass-mediated society, my understanding of how horror operates is much more as a control mechanism. So I was very influenced by William Burroughs's notion of control and also situationist ideas about the society of the spectacle. I mean, I was when I was younger. And I was very interested in how extreme representations of transgression tended to support conservative values ultimately, and to create a world in which our fears of something horribly other helped keep us in line, basically. So I felt that horror films had a kind of terroristic function to keep people on the straight and narrow, rather than as a revolutionary function on the whole, to encourage people to think entirely differently about the world around them.
That's an interesting conclusion, and I wanted to share something real quick from your book, Undead Uprising. It's around this same topic of George Bataille, who you mentioned, and the term video nasty, which you also mentioned. And the quote is this: "It was precisely the forces of base materialism intimately encountered in the ritual of sacrifice that Bataille believed had the potential to ignite, quote-unquote, real revolution." So obviously that's a little vague without context around it, what you're talking about in the book, but it does sort of tie into what we're talking about here. Could you give us a little context into what that quote means, what Bataille meant by real revolution, and I guess why you think horror isn't doing that for us right now?
So the terms that need unpacking there are, firstly, base materialism. Bataille's notion of base materialism was founded primarily on his understanding of the sacred and the powers of the sacred in everyday life, or in life, human life. He was indebted to the work of Durkheim, Emil Durkheim, and his nephew Marcel Mauss. So to cut a very long story short, the elementary forms of the religious life, Durkheim says that all societies are ultimately religious, even ostensibly secular societies, if they have a belief in the differentiation between the sacred and the profane, the prohibited and the permissible, hence Bataille's preoccupation with transgression, which of course is that which crosses the line of what is permissible with any particular culture. And for Bataille, transgression and the sacred were inevitably linked together. They're an inseparable concept. So he believed in the powers of the sacred, and the powers of the sacred for Bataille, this is a complex theoretical formulation which is best laid out in his book Theory of Religion, where he talks about the way in which humans develop a concept of the sacred, which has fundamentally to do with their separation from what he calls animal intimacy. That's a kind of relationship to the world. He says the animal exists in the world like water in water. And humans, through language and their use of tools, are separated from this realm of animal intimacy, but they seek desperately to become continuous with it again. And the experience of the sacred is an experience of this momentous continuum with the forces of the natural universe, the material universe. And so the forces of the material universe can be held in two different kinds of dimensions, or there's an out-of-control dimension of base matter, and there's a more in-control dimension of organized matter. And these, for Bataille, were understood in terms of what he called the homogeneous order of the world, the making of the same, and heterogeneity, which is absolute difference, that which is irreconcilable. And these roughly coincided to the right-handed and left-handed paths of the sacred, for anybody who is interested in, you know, mystical occult traditions. And so he was very much a left-handed mystic who believed in these powerful forces of unlimited nature that could be accessed through transgression and sacrifice. Sacrifice was the privileged means by which we encountered these cosmic forces of ineluctable nature and matter. And this is a very different conception of materialism than the kind of materialism that was propounded by philosophical materialism, although it has links to that in the sense that the universe is governed by physical laws and there is no divine or metaphysical principle. And Marxist materialism or dialectical materialism, which he had a complex relationship with, which of course is the argument that there is this dialectical process by which historical unfolding happens, and whether or not it's guided by purely material economic principles or spiritual idealistic principles, the kind of Hegel-Marx argument, was something he was involved with too. But when Bataille talked about base materialism, he was talking about the abject, the filthy, the rotten, the cadaverous, those things which inspire within us an intense feeling of disgust and repulsion. And it was the disgusting, repulsive forces of the sacred that for Bataille had the most potentially revolutionary power. And most importantly, they could overthrow idealistic formulations of the sacred, which tended to be sovereign, idealistic, sovereign in a kind of unified monarchical sense rather than an individual sense, but the ordering forces of the universe. A good example would be the contrast between Apollo and Dionysus in the thought of Nietzsche. So Bataille was certainly more Dionysian than he was Apollinean. And then, so this base material conception of the universe and the belief that the forces of the left-handed sacred could be unleashed through ritual sacrifice was a belief that he had, which I ultimately think derived from the ceremony which began the Haitian Revolution. I can't prove that, but my research has led me to think that it's an idea that had been around for some time, and its source was the Bois Caiman ceremony that began the Haitian Revolution.
Yeah, I'm glad you mentioned that because, you know, that is the context of your work here, at least in this book. The subtitle of the book is Haiti, Horror in the Zombie Complex. So we did have to connect that at some point, and you just did. So let's back up, though, to, I guess, a more base conversation to set the table here. Let's talk about the word zombie. This brings with it a lot of potential definitions and interpretations depending on how it's used. And you wrote in the book that it's both myth and metaphor and performs a vast range of allegorical functions. I was wondering if you could just break down those functions for us and what this word means and how it's used.
Okay. I used two diagrams in the book, which kind of demarcate the first and second sections of the book. They're the kind of handiest way to think through this transforming idea of the zombie. There's the Haitian folkloric zombie. The Haitian folkloric zombie is a being which has been a human being that has been raised from the grave by a left-handed bokor or a witch doctor. You know, that's not a term that would be used there. Bokor would be the term that would be used, whose soul has been captured and is put to work by that magician, sorcerer. The origins of that idea are very complex and I don't think have really been thoroughly analyzed or to with any degree of consensus. This is what you find when you research Haitian folklore, in particular the history of voodoo, because it was underground and illegal, underground before the Haitian Revolution and illegal during most of the Haitian Republic until quite recently. It was a very marginalized, misunderstood, esoteric, protected religion that it's hard to get kind of scholarly certainty about. But we are quite sure that the idea of zombie, the word zombie, although, again, people argue with this, but one of the strongest understandings of the roots of that term are from West Africa, from the notion of unzambi, which can mean either a god or a spirit, but certainly Nzambi's some kind of mystical spirit. There's another argument that it comes from a Taino word for Zemi, which Maya Deren speaks about, and there's people who hold that belief too. I don't know how you would prove that, given that the Taino people were exterminated pretty quickly and there's very few remnants of that culture left. But the term certainly, most strongly it seems, came from Africa and means a kind of spirit. In Haitian folklore, there are two kinds of zombie, the zombie cadavre and the zombie astral. Both the zombie cadavre and the zombie astral are spirits that have been captured by a bokor. The zombie astral is more like a ghost. It's the idea that you could catch somebody's soul and send that into people's dreams and use it for your bidding, to frighten people, to manipulate people, to find things out. So that's the zombie astral. And the zombie cadaver is what we understand, ordinarily understand as a zombie, is a kind of living dead person. And within Haitian folklore, the secrets to creating the living dead are held by secret societies called variously, well, often usually called Bizango, but there are other names for these secret societies, who tend to control the society and communities in the countryside in Haiti. And they have the secrets of creating zombies. There's, and it's largely seen as a, you know, something that would be a kind of punishment if you transgressed certain cultural and social rules. It's something to be frightened of. It's something that works in folklore, that people are very terrified of being turned into a zombie. It's something that Haitian people believe in as a practice, and there is some evidence that people have been turned into zombies. So this is the Haitian folkloric notion of the zombie, which was made more widely known by, firstly, by William Seabrook's book, The Magic Island, 1928, which introduced the word zombie to popular Western culture. And in that context, the zombies were people risen from the dead who were working on the in the cane fields of Haiti in the 1920s. In the book, I point out that those people working in the cane fields who seem to have their will taken away from them seem very much like the kind of people who would have been working under sugar plantations during slavery. Of course, a slave is someone who has had their will taken away from them. And certainly the popular Western idea of the zombie, once it's removed from the Haitian folkloric context, very much resonates with this idea of the plantation slave, the person who is forced to work against their will, whose power for self-determination has been entirely crushed. And so the zombie becomes a figure for the slave, a horror figure for the mindless slave by the 1920s and 30s in Western popular culture. And what I argue is that, and this is an important part of the whole argument in the book, is that the zombie figure as it migrates into Western popular culture coincides with the somnambulist, which was already a kind of important figure for, similarly a figure for what I call an agent without autonomy. In fact, more precisely, a remotely controlled agent without autonomy. So the somnambulist or the sleepwalker or the person put into a hypnotic trance, like the zombie slave, seemed to be a being who was unable to resist the compulsions of its master and was unable to act on its own self-determination and with its own will. So these two figures coincided. So you get films like, you know, I Walked with a Zombie, which in the 1940s, which has both the white female somnambulist and the black resurrected zombie in the same narrative. You get the first zombie film, White Zombie, 1931, which again has a woman who is put into a zombic trance and by an evil magician who also has the power to, you know, force slaves to work in his plantation. So the somnambulist and the zombie coincide in Western popular culture, and they both represent these figures who have absolutely no sense, no ability to determine their own actions. Their actions are willed by remotely by another being. So that's the kind of first phase of zombiedom. And that's kind of what sticks around until famously George A. Romero makes Night of the Living Dead in 1968. And it's an interesting moment because Romero didn't call the living dead in his film zombies. That's a name that came afterwards. He called them ghouls, which is another kind of tradition. So he wasn't even thinking of them in terms of the Haitian zombie. They obviously were reminiscent of, well, they were beings that had been resurrected from the dead and forced to walk the earth in a cadaverous state. He also introduced the kind of trope of eating human flesh, which hadn't been associated with a zombie up until that point, except in roundabout ways, which we could perhaps get into. So the new zombie figure is apocalyptic and absolutely out of control, and most importantly, it's a kind of a plague. It's something that is spreading and growing and can't be stopped. this is all very new. This is not part of the Haitian narrative or the classic cinematic zombie narrative. But by 68, that's the character it's taken. So from the 60s onwards, the new zombie, what I call the apocalyptic cannibal zombie, is an entity which represents completely out of control nature. And so what marks the new zombie is, what differentiates them is that they're not controlled by anything. And also there's no magical or esoteric practices underpinning the resurrection of the dead. It's, you know, there's no more room in hell, simply, as George Romero put it. So those are the kind of histories of the figure. In terms of the metaphors, you know, by the 50s, already the zombie metaphor had started to be introduced for anything that seemed to be alive when it shouldn't be, or something that wouldn't die properly. But it also came to represent kind of different kinds of political beliefs and values. So, you know, zombie conservatives or zombie Marxists, and you know, it could be anybody who seems to be not thinking for themselves, basically, was a person who was, could be described as a zombie, who was just going through the motions without consciousness. So that's a brief overview of the various dimensions, but it gives the kind of spine of the thing.
Definitely, yeah. And, you know, correct me if I'm wrong here, but does the term you use in the book called the zombie complex, is that different than what you just described? Does that bring in more of a psychological, and I think you just said consciousness, is that bring in these sorts of subjects more than what you just said?
Yeah, very much so. In a nutshell, the zombie complex is these two very extreme poles of how we popularly understand the zombie figure. On the one hand, absolutely passive and docile, without a will of its own, totally controlled from the outside by forces greater than itself, and with no awareness that it's being controlled from the outside. That's the kind of passive zombie. On the other side, you have the insurrectionary zombie, which is completely out of control, you know, cannot be stopped. There's nothing you can do to prevent it ravaging your existence. And these two poles represent what the two poles of what I call the zombie complex. So it's how can this figure have these two very different modalities of being? And that's really, yeah, that's what I mean by the zombie complex. And what I try to answer in the book is why they can have those two very distinct modalities of being. And I ultimately trace that back. And I don't think it's an absolute reduction. I think it's just relative to the narrative that I was examining there, of the migration of the Haitian zombie into Western popular culture. But my conclusion was that it has something to do with the configuration of the insurrectionary black slaves in Haiti during the revolution, that they needed to be configured both on the one hand as utterly passive, devoid of historical agency, self-conscious historical agency. They couldn't be real revolutionaries. They couldn't be really enlightened because they were black. This is a narrative which you'll find kind of echoed in the writings of Kant and Hegel and other important Western Enlightenment philosophers. And on the other hand, when they did become revolutionary, they weren't doing it in the, you know, the good way that I guess white Europeans do revolution. They were doing it in some savage, barbaric way. You know, their mode of revolutionary subjectivity was more evil and malign than other modes of revolutionary subjectivity that white European Enlightenment thinkers seemed to be endorsing, people like Rousseau, for instance, and others. So my sense is that the zombie complex, this bipolar idea of the zombie, has its roots in issues specifically to do with blackness at the dawn of the Haitian Revolution, and the fact that we've never really come to terms with the implications for that moment in history.
I want to read something here, and it just sort of encapsulates what you just said. But you wrote in the book, ultimately at stake in the zombie complex are a series of questions about consciousness, violence, morality, and economics, and a dialectic of remembering and forgetting, awareness and oblivion about the unbeing's historical origins and the conditions which have accelerated and propagated its spectacular ubiquity at the dawn of a new millennium. In this
that
sense,
was a
the zombies,
sense, wasn't it?
Yeah. And then the last part of that is, in this sense, the zombies that concern Undead Uprising are all in one form or another zombies of historical consciousness. So what you're saying there, definitely that quote encapsulates, like I said, but I'm wondering too, could this zombie complex or zombie consciousness now, what does it mean now? Because now I see it more maybe as an analogy for capitalism and the labor force and general Western consumerism. Is that something that you would agree with?
Well, there was certainly a moment when the zombie came to represent mindless consumerism in Western culture. And that was, you know, most notoriously Romero's Dawn of the Dead film, where the zombies attack the shopping. Well, they find themselves compelled to return to the shopping mall. And that's been read by many people as an allegory for mindless consumerism and the way in which Western capitalist society, we are compelled to consume. I have no significant arguments with that. I think that's fine. I think, you know, it's an appropriate way, a metaphor for thinking about mindless consumerism. But I suppose it's more the mindlessness question and, you know, who's assumed to be attributed with the properties of mind and self-consciousness. I didn't dig very deeply into this in the book. I touch upon it, as you mentioned, in various places. One of the texts that I touch upon but don't dig into too deeply is the Sentience and Behavior essay, where the zombie problem was introduced to consciousness studies in the 1970s, and it became called the zombie problem. It wasn't really, although the analogy itself isn't what we'd ordinarily think of as a zombie. So the figure that Kirk talks about is a replica, basically. It's much closer to, let's say, Philip K. Dick's replicant or a simulant. So the idea would be, how can you know that if something is, that another being has self-consciousness? You know, what enables you to be sure that another being is conscious? Now, this is also called the other mind's problem in the philosophy of consciousness. And I think that the figure of the zombie and the figure, the kind of science fiction figure of the replicant or the simulant have something in common, which is this question of, you know, what is the other's capacity for self-consciousness and enlightenment? And when you configure that back in the history of plantation slavery and the construction of racism during the plantation era, again, it's a huge topic, and you know, I don't want to be trite about it, but the very principles or the fundamental philosophical foundations for modern enlightened democracy, the capacity of the individual subject to reason for themselves and to make reasoned decisions about what's in their own best self-interest, was historically and socially excluded from black populations. I mean, one of the constructions historically of racism was that black populations were deemed to not have this capacity for enlightened self-interest and reason, which is why Hegel, when he wrote The Phenomenology of Spirit, was able to have this it's a very influential parable of the master and the slave, in full awareness of the revolution that had taken place in Haiti against white slavery, but didn't acknowledge that Haitians had made this momentous step in social progress. Primarily, I mean, not exclusively, but in some ways that was because people of African extraction, black people, were deemed not to be capable of the kind of historical conscious and self-awareness that was necessary to become a fully enlightened subject. So what I find going on when I think about the zombie problem is these shadows of racism, the echoes of the construction of an enlightened subject that we accept as given now to a large extent. But the echoes of the history of racism within that figure is what I keep coming back to. And again, I can't be much clearer on that at the moment, but that's kind of, you know, what I'm thinking. I mean, the example would be a lot of radical black scholars from the 1930s and 40s onwards. I mean, think people like René Depeste or Frantz Fanon would use the zombie figure too, and would acknowledge that the zombie figure was a kind of curse that people of African ancestry were particularly subject to, given the historical circumstances under which they'd been brought from Africa and forced into slavery, and that they disidentified, but the zombie figure became a kind of a metaphor for some black intellectuals for life under slavery and life after slavery, after emancipation, that one still labored under a kind of within this kind of state of undeadness or living deadness. So those are the questions that I'm kind of more focused on now.
Okay. Well, let me throw this at you too. On some level, are we also talking about psychological suggestion and imitation of behavior that you see in like with art and media? It conjures up in my mind the word meme, you know, how this stuff spreads like a virus, not dissimilar to the way, I guess, zombification spreads in fiction. And I think also we're talking about a term called animal magnetism, which some listeners may be familiar with because it's typically referred to as hypnotism, right?
Yeah, that's right. It's interesting. What I'm going to do, I can see what I'm doing. You ask me a question, I go rambling on, and I forget precisely what the question was, but I'll come back because there's some key points there. I will talk about animal magnetism and hypnosis. And this power of suggestion is a very, very important term. It's one of those terms. And I say it's important because I was just thinking the other day, I was always, you know, as one does all the time, that I heard about this idea of the power of suggestion when I was very young. It was a powerful idea. So the idea of the power of suggestion, that you could be made to do something against your will without really knowing it. Someone could, you know, as a kid, people would say, you know, if Johnny told you to jump off a cliff, would you? And then you go, of course not. But then you think, well, why would I do that? And then there's this idea that someone could suggest something to you and you just do it because you would. So the power of suggestion is a very elementary, powerful idea that I think I had come across very early on. And the power of suggestion, the idea of suggestion, was very much associated, came to be strongly associated with this notion of hypnosis. And if, for those who aren't familiar, a brief history of the kind of practice of hypnosis, it began with a character called Anton Mesmer back in the 18th century, who developed a theory of physical ailments, which he called animal magnetism. Basically, it was a kind of enlightenment physician's idea that the universe was permeated by this matter energy called ether. The entire universe was permeated by an ethereal energy force. And this ethereal energy force could be blocked in the body in malign ways. And if it was blocked, you know, you got sick. So the animal magnetists or mesmerists developed techniques for unleashing the blocked energies of the body. And this technique was called animal magnetism. And it was a huge fad, a big craze. There was lots of stuff written about it in Paris just before the French Revolution. So there's a lot of great work on that. But within that, shortly after Mesmer created these societies of harmony and he had many followers, not least a character called the Marquis de Puysegur, who's very important for the history of Haiti, well, his brother. And the Marquis de Puysegur was an Alsatian nobleman who developed what he called false sleep or somnambulism. And in the state of false sleep, people could be made to do things through suggestion. So they started to learn that you could say to somebody, go and do something that they ordinarily wouldn't have done, but in a state of hypnotic sleep, they could be made to do it. So this relationship between hypnotic sleep and a state of a more open state for suggestion became a big theme within the discourse of hypnosis at the end of the 18th century and the beginning of the 19th, in fact, through the 19th century, where, you know, stage hypnotists would, one of the famous examples of stage hypnotism was, you know, getting people to maybe commit acts of murder. It became a kind of part of a kind of hypnotic literature at the time that people could be compelled to do things against their will, such as killing people, which I'll just bracket this off. This is very important for the video nasty controversy, because one of the arguments against video nasties was that young, impressionable people who watch sadistic, violent videos are somehow going to be hypnotized into committing those acts themselves. This was a big part of the panic, that if you watch something, it's the copycat effect. So the copycat effect is like the power of suggestion writ large when it comes to violent media. So, so this is the power of suggestion through hypnosis. And the somnambulistic subject, the subject who's had their will taken away from them and could be compelled to do something malign or criminal, the criminal somnambulist, was a big idea. It's in a lot of early silent films. It's there in The Cabinet of Dr. Caligari. You know, it's a hugely important trope in modern horror. And it had its place in Haiti because many of the people who followed Anton Mesmer were revolutionaries, abolitionists, and Masons. And there was a big community of abolitionist Masons in what was called Saint-Domingue before the revolution. And Mesmerists went to Haiti. And one of the real attractors for my research was when I discovered that Anton Mesmer claimed responsibility for the foundation of the Haitian Republic, which seemed like a ridiculous idea, until I dug deeper into it. And strangely enough, there are stories, historically documented stories, that the Haitian slaves practiced some form of animal magnetism, which may or may not have been voodoo. But whether it was voodoo or not, the effects were the same. People could be compelled to do things against their will, and that people may be subject to a new kind of mastery other than their slaveholders. There was a suppression of animal magnetism, mesmerism, in Saint-Domingue just before the revolution. And the parallels between animal magnetism and what's known of voodoo ceremonials back then are quite striking, particularly the notion of possession trance, which occurs in both cases. So, and the use of a mediumistic master of ceremonies, we call them a physician or a hungan or a priest, but the people who are able to somehow control these violent, disruptive crises that people went into when they were in a state of possession trance. So the possession trance power of suggestion themes really do coincide very strongly in pre-revolutionary Haiti.
Yeah, and let's give the audience some background on the geopolitical and historical significance of the Haitian Revolution and why it makes up a large portion of your book here, because I didn't know what to expect when I read the book, but when I came out of reading it, I felt like I came out as a scholar of the Haitian Revolution more than I did, you know, like this is a zombie horror theme that we're kind of talking about so far. So give us some background on why the Haitian Revolution geopolitically was so important and how it ties into your work here.
Okay, so in a nutshell, rather briefly, Saint-Domingue was the wealthiest colony in the world, I think, at that time, just before the Haitian Revolution. So the end of the 18th century, it was producing vast amounts of wealth. The people who lived there lived in excessive splendor and luxury. But of course, the entire system was based on slavery, black slavery, slaves from West Africa who were brought there to labor in the cane fields, etc. You know the story. It's a fairly straightforward historical picture. When the French Revolution happened in 1789, news of it spread very quickly to the plantation elites in Haiti. And of course, as when you have a revolution or a war within a colonial empire, whatever the political changes occur back in the motherland are going to have consequences in the colonies too. But the way in which those consequences unfold are very different due to the nature of the colony and the way in which the power is organized within the colony. So although the French Revolution abolished slavery in France, whether or not that abolition of slavery extended to the colonies was a complex question. Of course, it was in principle it should have done, but in reality, the abolition of slavery didn't occur really in many countries till much later. So in principle, the Declaration of the Rights of Man abolished slavery, but in practice in the colonies, it was kind of, not yet. Obviously, the reasons for that were primarily economic, and that France would lose the wealth derived from the colonies if it was to abolish slavery there. They wouldn't be able to extract wealth from the slave populations and the resources there. So, but within Haiti, again, this is all historically documented in various texts, but C.L.R. James, The Black Jacobins, is a very good text that tells this story. So there was an uprising in Haiti against slavery that took its inspiration partly from the news of the revolution in France and the idea of the Declaration of the Rights of Man. And in 1791, the first phase of the uprising began in a ceremony which I write quite a lot about, which is kind of central, this Boakaiman ceremony, in which a black pig was sacrificed to the African gods, or so we believe. and the insurrection began. It began in 1791, but it led to a 13-year war, a brutal war in which many people took different sides. The English were involved, the Spanish, the French. Toussaint Louverture led the first phase of the Revolutionary War, but made lots of compromises. He eventually ended up dying in a French prison in the Alps somewhere. And by 1804, the war was won. The Napoleonic forces were repelled, and the declaration of a free Haiti was declared by Jean-Jacques Dessalines in 1804, which was the first slave-free republic in the world. And so it was a momentous occasion for the principle and spirit of the Revolutionary Enlightenment. But of course, it was immediately suppressed and repressed by colonial powers, because the last thing they wanted were more slave revolts in their slave-holding colonies, whether they were French slave-holding colonies, British slave-holding colonies, or Spanish. So the revolution was suppressed. It was said to be not a real revolution. It was historically premature. Blacks couldn't possibly, you know, govern themselves in an enlightened fashion, et cetera, et cetera. So the Haitian Revolution and the history of the Haitian Republic is one in which this incredible historical triumph was kind of quashed or denied by the other powers in writing historical narratives. And Haiti suffered from that ever since. We still don't think of Haiti as a world-leading country on the stage of history, but that's what it was. So that's why my kind of concerns, you know, being an old kind of idealist revolutionary, I was always interested in what constitutes this historical consciousness by which a people decide that it's time to rise up and overthrow their oppressive masters. And so Haiti is a very important place to look at for that. But more kind of importantly is why that history has been suppressed and silenced, and why no one sees Haiti as an important country in the history of enlightened democracy.
Well, you know, and that makes me wonder, John, how much of what we know about Haiti and the history of Haiti, or I guess what we think we know about it too, is just steeped in political propaganda or outright racism?
Well, a lot. I don't want to overstate this, but it's kind of easy to overstate that the reason we don't know much about Haiti or its history is because of European and colonial suppression of that history and denial of that history. And there are countless examples of lies, deceptions, and extortion against Haiti. You know, the reparations it was forced to pay to France. So, I mean, there's a whole list of events, historical facts about what the colonial powers did to Haiti to punish it for becoming the first independent black republic that are well documented. So, you know, as I say, the most kind of famous one people usually reach for first is the reparations that in order to continue trading with France, because of course Haiti couldn't make any money if it wasn't part of the global economy, because obviously it had developed as part of that transatlantic slave trade and the plantation economy and the emergence of an integrated world economic system. Once it was cut off from that integrated world economic system, it was impoverished. You had to be part of the game. So France asked for reparations for its losses during the Revolutionary War, which I can't remember the name of the French president, eventually agreed to, I think in the 1820s. And it took a century for Haiti to pay back the reparations to France in order to be able to continue to start trading again in the world market. So Haiti's been indebted for its victory since the revolution. That's just one example, but it's well known in Haiti and it's well known for Haitian scholars, but it's not well known outside of that. The other the kind of defamation of Haiti as a country has just continued, you know, quite extremely. There's an amazing book by Spencer St. John called Haiti or the Black Republic. Spencer St. John was a British consul to Haiti, and in his fully endorsed, published book on Haiti, he made the claim that all Haitians are cannibals and that even the elite are cannibals and that they regularly partake of a kind of cannibal meal, especially on New Year's, apparently. And the Haitian government has systematically attempted to obscure the fact of this, and he's going to reveal it to the world. I mean, it's ludicrous, absolutely ludicrous. But these were books that were being written and read by European publics. So the image of Haiti as a land mired in primitive superstition, trapped in archaic African atavisms and full of cannibals and, you know, voodoo sacrifice taking place deep in the woods is one that was promoted and perpetuated by colonial writers in order to create a bad picture of Haiti. And writers like, you know, amazing writers and statesmen like Antonin Firmin, who was a European educated anthropologist, statesman, who wrote a fantastic book, a response to, there's a famous book by a French writer called Gobineau called On the Inequality of the Human Races. And Antonin Firmin wrote a riposte, a fully researched riposte called On the Equality of the Human Races. He was opposed to American occupation. This is another part of the story, the American occupation of Haiti from 1915 to 1934, which is when Seabrook wrote his book, but we'll go back to that. But yeah, so to cut a very long story short, there has been a systematic propagandistic attempt to suppress the heroic history of Haitian independence that has been explicitly racist in many of its manifestations.
Yeah, and I think in order to understand this more completely as well, especially bringing this up to maybe a more modern time, we have to understand this character Papa Doc and the political and geopolitical climate in Haiti during his reign as the quote-unquote voodoo dictator. A lot of folks called him a zombie in the literal undead sense. So who was this zombie voodoo dictator Papa Doc, and why did he apparently want severed heads on his doorstep?
For Haitians and people in the Haitian diaspora, you know, Papa Doc is a very uncomfortable part of their history and an unfortunate part. But he is undeniably an important part of the history of Haiti. Now, François Duvalier was biochemist. He worked with a poor population in Haiti when he was younger. He was trained in America. He helped cure this thing called yaws, which was a disease which was severely affecting poor people in Haiti. So his name Papa Doc became from him being a country doctor and a well-loved country doctor in Haiti. It's a complex story, but we shall try to reduce to without oversimplifying. In the 1920s and 30s, in response to the American occupation of Haiti, which was a very racist occupation, forced, you know, Haitians were forced back into labor for public construction works, etc. So forced labor was introduced. And in fact, interestingly, voodoo was used to find the people for forced labor. So if you were found to have some kind of voodoo paraphernalia in your where you lived, you would be arrested and put into forced labor. So there's a direct correlation between being a voodooist, practicing voodoo and being punished by forced labor during the American occupation. So there was a lot of hostility amongst young intellectuals, quite rightly, towards the occupation. And there was a renewed sense of appreciation for African history, the African roots of the Haitian people, voodoo in particular, because voodoo had been kind of attempt to stamp voodoo out. And so voodoo became a kind of important cultural phenomena for Haitians who wanted to affirm the importance of the African heritage of Haiti, the spiritual cultural heritage. And so there was a pro-voodoo kind of counter-movement amongst Black intellectuals and artists and writers in Haiti in the 20s, which carried on into the 1930s. The occupation ended in 1934. And this renewed interest in voodoo was taken up by many intellectuals, including Duvalier, who also researched the history and knew a lot about what was going on in the countryside, which is where voodoo is still practiced. So although I should say people don't call it voodoo, they call it serving the spirits, but that's a different story. But so people who follow the religion we call voodoo. And he realized that to really speak to the Haitian masses and the Haitian peasants, you had to understand and work with the loi or the spirits. And there was a power to that was important to use. And so legend has it, and so that's something I look at quite closely in the book. Legend has it that Papa Doc emulated this figure called Baron Samedi. Baron Samedi is a voodoo loa. The loa are the spirits of voodoo. These are the gods, the beings, the spirits. There are many of them. There's a kind of hierarchy of them. Some are more well-known than others. There are lesser-known ones. There are differences depending on what are called the nations of voodoo. That is the groupings of voodoo determined largely by which part of Africa the people's ancestors came from, whether it was Dahomey or Congo or Fon, whatever. And the Gede family are a fairly new family, actually, that seem to be somewhat outside of these other traditions. And Baron Samedi is a major figure in that Gede tradition, And the Gede are the spirits of the graveyard, and Baron Samedi is a figure associated with the graveyard. He wears the top hat and a kind of dinner suit, and he has the signs of the undertaker and the mason, the coffin maker. He's like the person who leads the coffins in a funeral ceremony. This is the kind of character that Baron Samedi is or represents. So he's associated with graveyards in Haiti, and he's associated with the dead. And he is, by some accounts, the master of zombies. There's an interesting link between Freemasonry and the resurrection of the initiates in Freemasonry and the bringing back to life of the dead. There's a whole lot of mythology around that. But certainly he seems to be a spirit of the dead and the Gede spirit. So legend, which I traced to Graham Greene and before that to Ian Fleming, interestingly enough, the author of James Bond, Live and Let Die, which is the most famous, where most people know this Baron Samedi figure from the 1973 Live and Let Die film. But interestingly, Ian Fleming had created this character, this Baron Samedi voodoo dictator in 1954, which was 3 years before Papa Doc came to power. So there's something quite prescient about that. But he seemed to emulate Baron Samedi, and people said that he was emulating him, and many people believed he'd sold his soul and that he may well be a zombie. So he was the voodoo dictator to Western media, particularly, and to some people within Haiti. It was mainly Western journalists who called him who associated this Baron Samedi figure with Papa Doc. But he did, he created an army of militia called the Tonton Macoutes, who dressed like Papa Zaka, one of the voodoo loa. And, he was a black nationalist. It was a brutal black nationalist totalitarian politics. What's important about that, I guess, is that, we see that fascism, there can be white fascism and black fascism. And he was a kind of black fascist nationalist who believed in the black race and the black race's own historical destiny and its ability to control its own historical destiny. So he was an anti-white black nationalist who created a kind of a voodoo dictatorship. It wasn't really voodoo. It was a dictatorship, basically, that used voodoo in his own interest, really, and to bring, I guess, the peasant masses on board, the black peasant masses on board for his political campaign. And he also, was very angry about the anti-superstition campaign. So he was quite aggressive towards the Catholic Church, too. He forced a lot of Catholic priests into exile because they'd been on the forefront of the anti-superstition campaigns in the 1940s. So he became this so-called voodoo dictator who reputedly emulated Baron Samedi. But within, Haitian intellectuals at the time, people like René Depeste, who was exiled during the Duvalier dictatorship, they did see that there was a certain return to an idea of every Haitian person being zombified, being controlled by this powerful presidential figure who believed himself to be the reincarnation of Jean-Jacques Dessalines. So this is documented. He did believe that he was a reincarnation of the heroic figures of the Haitian Revolution. And now apparently he has been also deified, and he returns in certain ceremonies as a lower OS 22. He had a magic number, 22. And he apparently does occur in voodoo ceremonies now. So he can possess participants in the ceremonies. So he, for pretty much from 1957 until 1986, he eventually gave over his presidency for life to his son, Jean-Claude Duvalier, Baby Doc. And they basically bled the country dry and, created a very, very unhappy state of affairs for Haitians during the long years of the dictatorship. And for many, and the reason why I'm, it's very easy to vilify and point out. And in my book, I used Duvalier right at the very beginning as a kind of way of introducing the book. I'm conscious that it's very easy to point to Duvalier and say, well, look, this is what happens when you have voodoo and politics going together. And, it can appear like a kind of potentially racist, xenophobic, anti-Haitian thing to do, to point immediately to Papa Doc. But a lot of the myths about contemporary myths about the dangers of voodoo and black despotism really did congeal in the 1970s around Papa Doc. And Haiti was once again condemned for being a nation incapable of ruling itself fairly and with justice. And again, the reason for that was seen to be this this taint of African voodoo that was somehow preventing Haiti from being a place of true social justice, let's say.
Yeah, and what was the anecdote about the severed heads again?
This is interesting because I did point, you know, that section where I sort of list some of the horrors of the Duvalier regime, which are all documented. It is rumored that he wouldn't be sure that someone had been killed unless the head was brought to the palace. So if he said you had to go, someone needed to be murdered, it wouldn't be enough for the person to come back and say, yeah, we killed that person. The head had to be brought back too, so he would know for sure that person was dead. I took all those anecdotes from various journalistic accounts of rule of Papadoc. So how true they were, we will never know. But there's a lot of secondary journalistic evidence, and there's a lot of people who wanted Papadoc out of power, of course, as well. So there's lots of legends and rumors about the Duvaliers and the kind of things they were up to, the horrors they were committing. I think there's little doubt that he was a very ruthless, brutal, and repressive dictator who used pretty violent means to achieve his ends. He was very Machiavellian. But that's not unusual for dictators. And I think the important thing is that it wasn't his blackness that made him an evil dictator. It's a human thing to be an evil dictator.
Yeah, and I think you also mentioned that he may have wanted to watch people be murdered from like another room so he could, you know, like again, make sure that they were dead. And also, maybe he dined on some of those victims as well. So it's a good time to ask, John, what is Congo bean stew and why do I not want to eat it?
Well, you see, this is interesting because the way your question is going, and I'm happy with that, is that it points in, you know, and this is good. Because all those stories around Papadoc Duvalier and the horrors that he committed, the atrocities he was involved in, and, you know, these, as I said, these are atrocities that many people in power, excessive power, have committed, regardless, and I just want to point out, regardless of their race. So I don't believe that, despotic violence is anything to do with one's race. But I do recognize that the kind of, within narratives of Haiti, once you bring voodoo into alignment with these stories of black despotism, it starts to echo the kind of propagandistic stories that people like Spencer St. John wrote in the 19th century. So it echoes this story of vilification and defilement of the Haitian people in some way. So I'm kind of very sensitive to that. The Congo bean stew is a great example of that because it's, again, it's something that I think it was Spencer St. John and another writer wrote a book called American Mediterranean, who popularized these stories about that Haitians were committing, some Haitians were committing human sacrifice and that they were sacrificing children and putting them into food and eating it. So there's an anecdote called the Affaire de Besançon, which, again, I would need to sort of, my memory is going to be slightly vague on this to get my dates and my facts precise. But the Affaire de Besançon was something that Spencer St. John spoke about. Now, in this story, remember that voodoo is illegal. So anybody who's practicing, and voodoo involves a lot of animal sacrifice. It's one of the main parts of the religion, all that the Loa have different tastes, different appetites, and different Loa require different sacrifices. So it's animal sacrifice is a big part of Haitian voodoo. So it's easy to think that if you're able to sacrifice a pig or a goat or a cow or a chicken, that, you know, you may be under certain circumstances, one might be able to sacrifice a human. And this is not an unknown story. So I'm also not going to pretend that stories of human sacrifice don't occur in Haiti among Haitians too. The idea that human sacrifice, well, let's just face it, human sacrifice has been practiced quite a lot by humans. And again, not necessarily black humans, which is something Antonin Fermin points out in his book. The history of human sacrifice in the, you know, Judaic and Greek religions is well documented, even though, of course, the idea is that once you reach its new stage, once you stop doing human sacrifice. So I'm going around the houses here to say that in the Affaire de Besançon, apparently somebody had been seen to be killing and eating humans, a child, and Spencer St. John attended the trial. Now, the trial was probably, you know, cooked up by the authorities to, you know, who knows what the details were, but he was convinced and everyone was convinced that this was proof that the Haitians were committing, some Haitians were, Spencer St. John said all Haitians were doing it, but that some Haitians were performing human sacrifice and cooking this thing called Congo bean stew, which was a meal of human flesh, basically.
Yeah. I mean, hey, it's Halloween season, John. You can't get around a good cannibal discussion, even if you tried. So, John, I think that's a good place to wrap up. Please do tell people where they can find the book if they're interested and where they can keep up with your work on the internet.
I don't have much of an internet presence, but I do have a website called Invisible Mirrors, or MYONVZIB, Haitian Creole. So Invisible Mirrors, if you look that up. And Undead Uprising, you can find Strange Attractor books with the publishers. So, yeah. And if you look, you'll find me in other places too. And I'm doing some work on British Columbia right now, decolonization around this project called the Skullcracker Suite. So if you look up something called BC Time Slip, you'll find the research I'm doing there, which I'd be very happy for people to look at. It's just waiting to be known to the world, BC Time Slip. So that's about it. And I really appreciate you inviting me on. It's been great chatting.
Yeah, sorry there, John. I was searching BC Time Slip because I was interested in that. So
I mean, I really, you know, I tend to be quite off radar. My internet presence, I turn up in a few places. There's a podcast recently by Hermetics that I talked about some of my ideas around Georges Bataille and Mark Fisher and Nick Land and some of those ideas. That's in Hermetics, if you look up Hermetics, John Cussans. And I say BC Time Slip is where my most current research, which has to do with decolonization in British Columbia, specifically around the Kwakwaka'wakw people up there and their potlatch traditions. And also Philip K. Dick, who was up there in the 1970s and spent some time in a First Nations rehab clinic in the 1970s, which is a pretext for some work we're doing up there in British Columbia. So I'd really welcome people to come and visit the BC Time Slip site if they're interested in that research.
Well, I definitely am, just based on the title alone and what I'm reading about it here on the webpage. So yeah, maybe I have to schedule a follow-up here to talk more about this for sure.
Oh, I'd love to do that. Yeah, I'd really love to do that.
Awesome. All right. Well, Dr. John Cussans, thanks so much for being here. Really appreciate your time. Look forward to chatting with you again sometime soon.
Great. Thanks, Ryan. Have a great day.
And there you have it. My thanks again to Dr. John Cussans. You know what I found most thought-provoking about John's analysis of the modern zombie early in the conversation is what he said about all the magic and esoteric goodness being sucked out of its mythos. I believe he said that in the context of the resurrection of the dead. No magical or esoteric quality to that anymore. Probably a good analogy there to the modern Western mindset. No magical or esoteric quality to that either, for the most part. So it seems that the mythological or folkloric figure of the zombie, which was once vibrant and full of life, as weird as that sounds, it seems that the zombie has lost itself amidst a sea of robotic unimagination. Zombie robots, zombots. There's a techno-horror film idea in there somewhere. Anyway, in the Patreon extension, we talked more about the book The Magic Island and its fascinating, enigmatic author William Seabrook, who apparently was a pioneer in S&M, bondage type stuff, if you're into that. And he also spent some time with Aleister Crowley. I don't think those two anecdotes are related, but who knows. Also, a bit more about Seabrook's supposedly cannibalistic tendencies, the legacy of the first zombie film, White Zombie, cinema as hypnosis, the evolution of the zombie motif in cinema with the release of Night of the Living Dead, and finally John's idea that horror expresses what we truly desire. Something worth thinking about there. Of course, you can sign up to hear that extension and all others past and future by visiting patreon.com/occulture. 4 levels of support there starting at just $2 a month. You can join our newest patrons, Michelle, Greg, and Catherine, in helping keep this esoteric endeavor on the tracks, or maybe in the water, whichever is more appropriate. If you're on Patreon, it's probably in the water, all recent Trap or Treat episodes considered. Hey, also, as part of an ongoing initiative on Patreon, I've been giving away books, films, and other various prizes to patrons each month. But now, you don't have to be a patron to be eligible for those giveaways. I was doing that at the $5 or more level, but now all patrons at all levels and all of you are eligible for those giveaways. So if you want entered into these monthly giveaways and you're not already on Patreon, send your name and mailing address to occulture@protonmail.com. Your information is not shared with anyone, don't worry. It's just put into my spreadsheet, so in the event that you do win, I can mail you your winnings. So again, monthly giveaways now open to all listeners. Just send your name and mailing address to occulture@protonmail.com to enter. Anyway, that is it for me this time. So until next time, you've just been initiated into Occulture. I am Ryan Peverly reminding you to love yourself, think for yourself, and question authority.